You know, you can be an employer who's kind of dependent on somebody else to create a job for you and allow you, quote unquote, allow you to work there. And, you know, the concept that stuck with me is, you know, every hour you work, you get paid. And if you break your leg, you know, government aside, you're no longer getting a paycheck, right? And so you're kind of always at risk if that company goes under, if you get hurt, if you're unable to work, you know, whatever it is. Whereas if you get over to the investor side, you know, our rental properties, no matter what happens to me, if I break my leg, if I, you know, whatever, my investment properties are going to continue to make money. And so that concept of passive income versus active income, you know, sounds simple, but it was really an aha moment for me.
Hey guys, let me tell you about Folio Lands. We landlords fear complaining tenants, fast turnover, bad reviews and negative ROI. Over the years, I realized it happens because we lack a system. They streamline maintenance and repair requests by inviting our co-investors and repairmen into the app to foster smooth communications between us, the tenants and the suppliers. Over to FolioLens.com if you hate time-consuming admin tasks like tracking your property revenues, expenses, and due dates. So sign up for their newsletter at FolioLens.com and start managing your rental properties from anywhere in the world. Welcome to another episode of the Ideal Investor Show. My name is Axel Meyerhofer, and today we have an awesome guest, Jason, who is joining us, and he just told me that he has become a real investor now. So welcome, Jason.
Hi, thank you, Axel. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you for making the time. And can you tell us a little bit where you're reaching us from today and what you're up to these days?
Sure. Yeah. So I'm based outside of Sacramento, California, a small town near Placerville. So I've grown up, spent most of my life here in Northern California. We do a little bit of our investing here. That's kind of part of the story, but do a lot more of our investing out of state. California is kind of a unique area. I think, Axel, you know that as well as anybody.
That's exactly my strategy that I try to get to our mentoring clients on a regular basis. And I'm practicing it myself, probably out of the same reasons, is when you decide which kind of part of this really multi-piece puzzle of real estate investing do you actually want to be in? I came to the decision that I wanted to stay within the residential real estate investing component. And as soon as you look around, and I think at least for a while, Sacramento was still a little better. And I only know it because while I was still in the Air Force, I was briefly for about a year stationed at Mesa Air Force Base, which probably know. Used to be there.
So, yeah.
I still remember the story that they said, yeah, these little mole hills and stuff like that you see around here, that's all from the gold digging.
Yep. Right, a lot of history here from that. Yeah.
Right. But in general, I mean, California, and I think it's pretty much true most places along the coast, a few in that like 30 to 50 mile from the water corridor, it's very hard to find properties that perform well for investing. And so that's where we decided to go out of state. But this is about you today, Jason. So tell us a little bit, or how did you get into becoming a real estate investor?
Sure. Yeah. So my wife and I got married about 10 years ago. And at the time when we were single, we had both bought our own homes. And then when we got married, we decided we wanted to buy one together. And at the time, we're like, well, don't really know what to do with the homes that we had before, so we might as well rent them. And then I guess even before that, when I was single with my home, I was renting out my rooms kind of by the room, you know, sort of that house hacking thing without really knowing that I was doing that. It was, hey, you know, some buddies could help me pay this mortgage. That'd be nice, right? I didn't know there was a term for it or kind of a strategy there. I was like, okay, let's see what happens. And then so my wife and I got married. We decided to rent out our rentals about 10 years ago. And then about 12 months ago, I kind of was very passive with it, and we managed our properties ourselves, but never really thought of them as investments. We really kind of broke even, or, you know, as I kind of became a more sophisticated investor and realized we really lost money on them, when you start taking into account kind of all those ghost costs. So we were, you know, breaking even or losing a little bit of money on them. And it dawned on me that we had these properties here in California that had a ton of equity because things just kind of naturally appreciated over the last 10 years that weren't really making us any cash along the way. And then I said, and I asked myself, well, you know, what could we do if we had that equity, you know, somewhere else? And then I started doing some research and really kind of getting myself going and devouring all the books and podcasts and everything that I could. Yeah. And I realized, man, I got a significant amount of equity here that is making me $0, and without putting in any of my own money, you know, could be making me thousands of dollars each month. And so we started looking into out-of-state investing, and that's kind of where we are now.
Very good. Okay, cool. And before we maybe go back to some of the things you just mentioned, yeah, can you reveal some of the locations when you say out-of-state, which places you are investing now or looking at?
Sure. Yep. Yeah. So we currently own 4 single families in the Memphis area, which actually crosses Tennessee and Mississippi, and then 2 duplexes in St. Louis.
Oh, okay. Cool. Missouri.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yep. So kind of two markets, but 3 states technically.
Yeah. Very good. So yeah, I guess we have a similar path that we discovered, and maybe I've been on it a little longer, but it's always good to know there are other people who are doing it too.
Yeah, it definitely makes you feel better. You start realizing there's a real community out there, and people like yourself and others, you know, are happy to share that wisdom. And
yeah, exactly. It
gives you a little bit of confidence that you're not kind of going out left field by yourself.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think reassurance, right? Like, and it's not just because other people do it, you know, I call that the lemming effect. That shouldn't be the only driver just because others do it. But when you have conversations like you and I have right now, and we can tap into, okay, what were the driving factors and so forth, I think that gives, especially an audience like we have, a little bit of an idea, what is the mindset or what are the things to go through? So one thing I would like to go back for a moment from what you said earlier, and you said, well, we looked at the numbers, the aspect of looking at this from a cash flow perspective versus looking at it from an overall value perspective, if you could maybe.
Yeah, you're talking about maybe kind of compare and contrast appreciation.
But people might say, well, Jason, you said you didn't make many money, but you have a ton of equity. Isn't that money?
Yeah. Well, it's money today, right? If I sold those properties, right? So paper money isn't making me, you know, is good in theory. And with the way the market's been over the last 18 months, obviously that paper money or that appreciation accelerated significantly. And so, you know, it just made sense for us to, you know, if we looked at what I call what's called the return on equity, it was very small, right? So we were, you know, basically making nothing or negative and had all this equity. Whereas we could go and hopefully get some level of appreciation in some of these other markets, certainly not to the level of California, but we could get cash flow along the way. And for us, our goal was to get to the point where we are able to replace our income from, you know, I have a W-2 job, my wife runs her own business. We could replace some or all of that income and then become more full-time investors. And we're not there yet, but the cash flow is important for that versus the appreciation.
That's great. And thank you for explaining that. Now, one thing that some of my mentoring clients asked me, and they had, similar to what you were saying, bought a property kind of like within the same area that they live and they managed it themselves. Mm-hmm. And one of the questions came, okay, well, if you have a property that has had appreciation, meaning the equity is in the property partially because it got more valuable, but also partially because you probably paid some off over the years on the mortgage itself. And then the choice could be either to say, okay, well, I bought a property for, let's say, $350, and now it's worth $500, but the loan, the remaining loan on it is $300. So I've literally $200,000 sitting in there, like you call it, like that, or not performing equity, basically. Mm-hmm. And then the question becomes, okay, well, if I were to get something like a home equity line of credit or some sort of a loan against that value, let's say 80%, right? So that would be something like $160,000. If my property that I have right now, like you were saying, is maybe not making a lot of cash flow, but breaking even, am I better off to keep it, just tap into that equity and use $160,000 to get myself like 4 properties as you described, but still hold that asset, because it has probably potential to increase in more value, more appreciation over time? Or am I better off to sell it and take the whole money that I could get out of it, including what my original down payment was, plus what I paid down over the years that I held it, and take all of it and invest it? So how and why did you decide the way you did?
Yeah, that's a great question, because one of the downsides to selling and getting all that equity is the potential tax liability, right? Which can be significant. In our case, we chose to 1031 that, so we're not responsible or liable for that capital gains. But it adds a level of pressure. I don't know how familiar your audience is.
Yeah, let's touch on that after you talk about the reasoning, and then sure. The 1031, we do that as a second topic.
Good. Okay. So the reasoning for us was twofold. One, I think we wanted to make use of all of the equity. And to your point, typically you can only get 80% of that, so you'd still have a chunk of equity in there. The other reason was, well, I guess three reasons, is being local properties, we felt a need to manage them ourselves and felt a personal connection to them. And I found myself, running down there to fix the toilet. And we really wanted to get more, professional and serious about investing, which, probably means it's not my best use of my time to be, repairing, doing repairs. So by going out of state and selling these properties and going out of state, it really becomes much more of a spreadsheet numbers game, because obviously we're using a local property manager, and we could really think of it more as a business as opposed to almost like a hobby, which is kind of what it was before. So it allowed us to get more serious. And then also we wanted to get out of California with those properties, because we had some issues with tenants, and some of the landlord versus tenant laws in California are not very conducive to doing business here. So I guess a few things kind of packed into where it made more sense for us.
Okay, great. Yeah, that totally makes sense and is understandable. Now, for those people in the audience who aren't completely familiar with the 1031 exchange, in a nutshell, just to explain, the government basically says, if you already make living space available to the public, which is what you and I are doing, if we own a house, a 3-bedroom, 2-bath house somewhere in any community, regardless where it may be, and we offer it for some other family to rent it, we are basically making living space available to the public. And the government, the only other choice, how the public that doesn't have the means to buy, at least that's how I always explain it, the other choice would be government housing, and there are Section 8 rules and all kinds of things. But if the government has the choice to say, we need to invest and build houses and run houses and operate stuff versus private people do that, there is a good reason to say, well, if private people are willing to do that, then we prefer that. And that's, at least from my perspective, where that 1031 is just literally the number of a paragraph in the tax code comes in to say, well, if you continue to be willing to make housing available to the public, we are not going to tax you on the gains that you made when you held one house and now you're basically buying another one or two other ones or three other ones, as long as you stay within that frame. Now, you said something that I think is very important, and I want you to explain that and how that actually affected you and your wife. You said there's a little bit of pressure. So could you talk about the initial identification and then the final closing window and some of the other things that are associated with it?
Sure. And obviously I'm not a tax expert, so I'll give you that premise, but my understanding, the way we applied it is that there's a few different methods, but effectively that the government wants you to identify a number of properties, and there's a couple different rules you can use that are of like kind and are equal or greater value. And they want you to identify those in the first 45 days after closing. And then you have, if I remember correctly, I think it's 6 months to close, 90 days or 180 days.
Yeah, I always say 179. So you give yourself one extra.
There you go. Yeah, 180 days to actually close on enough of those properties to meet the rules. And again, there's a couple different rules in there and specifics, but that's kind of the general idea. So you end up with I called it the shot clock, right? You have the 45 days to identify. And for some people, that can cause you a lot of stress, for one, and two, force you into making a deal that you may not have wanted to do or may not be the ideal deal for you just to avoid the taxes. And maybe that makes sense, right? I mean, if you're talking about a, you know, big chunk in 1031 on a large amount of equity, maybe overpaying for a property by $5,000 or $10,000 is worth it. But at the same time, you know, again, it can add a level of stress. Luckily, in our case, we were able to, I think we identified and closed within, I think it was 50 days on five properties at the same time. So we did 1031 from one property into five and closed on those all at the same time. So we had a lot going on there, but for us, it wasn't all that stressful. We didn't have any properties fall out of contract or anything along those lines. So it worked out well for us, but it's a consideration. It's an event.
Yeah, absolutely. It is definitely an event. I went through something like that a couple of years ago, and there were a couple of lessons learned, and I want to touch on them real quick just because we came to this topic and it applies to your situation. Anybody who is not a complete novice investor but has a property with equity in it, and this could be one of the decision makers to say, okay, well, if I actually sell this already operating as an investment property completely, like we said, right, you guys made the decision, we sell the whole thing and we want to use the whole equity to do something new but don't want to pay taxes, you want to be prepared for that versus just to go back to that other option to say, okay, I just get a loan against the equity, mm-hmm. like a home equity loan, then suddenly none of that really plays a role. Then you have mm-hmm. all the time in the world to say, how do I actually apply that money? So that's one thing to be aware of. Now, when you make the decision like you did, Jason, to say, okay, we sell the property, then we have the 45 days. And I think one thing that happened actually to me, I had good advice when people said you always want to identify a few extra properties because you never know if all of the ones that you really want to get or that at least seem to be available to you right away will be available when you're actually ready to buy them within those 180 days. Mm-hmm. From my perspective, something to consider, and that is, are you going to exchange and buy the properties you acquire initially for cash, or are you financing them? Mm-hmm. If you're financing them, then financing five properties like you did is a little bit tricky because you either have to have some sort of an umbrella loan, or you have to really be on your toes getting all the paperwork for each one of the properties done, which can be a little easier when they all come from the same source. If you have then on top of that three or four different sellers or entities that you're buying from, that's more complicated. If you don't have only one lender but multiple lenders, that makes it more complicated. I had identified some properties, some I knew would probably just be for reserve. And in the very end, one of the properties ended up not being fully done, renovated and inspected and everything before the 180 days because the city had some issues with the renovation. So one thing that I had to decide, and I think that's a valuable lesson for people to realize, if you take your example, and I don't know exactly what the value was, but let's just say it was $600,000 to invest, and you got everything covered within the rules, 45 days, 180 days, or even less than that, and you bought five properties, and there is $80,000 left that you had planned for the last property. If that doesn't happen, then again, not a lawyer, not a tax, not a CPA, but you're only paying taxes on that unused part.
Yeah.
So that's something important to know. What I ended up doing is I asked my turnkey provider, do you have anything somewhere in the area between $70,000 and $90,000? And they happened to have one. And I only put like a few thousand dollars of my own money in and bought that last property cash mm-hmm. and then finance it after the fact, because then it doesn't matter. As long as you own it and close it within the 180 days, you're good to go. Don't have to pay taxes. So that's a little bit maybe of an excursion into that 1031, but it's an important, and I think the lesson that our audience hopefully can learn from this is whenever you get into the mindset and the framework of, I have an asset that I want to sell, I think it's very important to say, what is all involved and how can I come out of that sale and the subsequent purchase the best way? Not to forget, like you, and I'm very grateful that you brought that up, Jason, there is help from the government, but you have to play exactly by the rules. Otherwise, you may not have that benefit. And I mean, I know this from my deal. I was looking at $27,000 in taxes, and I'm really glad that I didn't have to pay that, right? So I don't know how much it was for you, but it can be actually kind of painful. Now, another thing that you mentioned is when you close to the property, there's a tendency to either be officially the property manager slash landlord, mm-hmm. or at least being involved. What's your experience when you go out of state, and how is that different since you've done it?
Yeah. So for us, when the two properties we had in state, you know, we were self-managing those, we were finding our own tenants, we were handling the maintenance, we were handling the paperwork, collecting, you know, kind of 100%. And then out of state, we've been, using a property manager. And I think one thing people should realize, and I think I sort of knew, but maybe not to the degree that we've experienced, is just because you have a property manager does not mean you're hands off. There certainly is a managing the manager, mentality that you have to have. I think a lot of investors talk about, you know, one of the most important things is finding a good property manager. And, you know, the property managers we have one for the Memphis area and one for the St. Louis area. They've been solid, but there's definitely been some, you know, having to get on them. Hey, you know, when are we starting this rehab? Hey, we just lost a week. Why aren't the contractors out there? And, you know, I feel like, property management is very much, you know, they have, you know, some of these property managers have thousands of homes under our management. And I think you kind of have to be the squeaky wheel to make sure that your properties are getting taken care of. Otherwise, you can kind of get lost in the shuffle.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great point. And especially when they grew into that 1,000 property size rather quickly. Mm-hmm. I have had one situation in an area around Chicago where property management organization went from about 120 to 900 in 3 years. Mm. And, you know, it's not a linear thing. If you had 10 people for your 120, it doesn't mean you need 1,000 people suddenly in your property management, but it's also pretty much not possible to just 8 or 6 or 8 or 10x the number of properties and not really significantly increase your staff, right? Mm-hmm. And so that was one of the pain points. And I think you pointed that out as well. When the number of properties overwhelms the number of people who are supposed to manage them, then it's really tricky. And the squeaky wheel thing is one thing. And even that may not always make sure that things happen. Now, with that in mind, have you considered or do you own any turnkeys?
I do. Yeah. So as part of our 1031, we did buy one turnkey. Yeah. Okay. And so that's actually the property manager that we use for all of our properties in the Memphis area. The turnkey one was a nice experience. It was tenanted before, you know, we even started. They had a signed lease, that tenant, you know, that property, they finished on time. The rehab was done. The tenants are happy. They've been in there and no problems there. Yeah, again, the struggle is, you know, we bought some of the other ones off the MLS that needed some rehab, and the rehab always tends to be one of the struggles, even for, you know, the property management companies as well as the contractor, you know, outside contractors.
Yeah, absolutely. So when you compare that, would you say that buying them and then having some like long distance management of the rehab, did that save you anything financially or psychologically or maybe both or not?
Well, psychologically, it was much easier to do the turnkey, okay. But the returns that we're getting, you know, the cash on cash return is higher for our MLS properties. So it's a trade-off, right? Which is to be expected, right? Just like with anything, right? The more work you put into it, the higher the return you would expect. And so it's more work to manage a rehab from afar, even using a property manager to do the rehab, than it is for a turnkey, which kind of comes, you know, already and ready to go. So.
Great. And thank you for confirming and pointing this out, because a lot of people that when I asked them in the beginning, what is your goal? What do you really want to accomplish with your investments? It's typically not, oh, I want another job. I want to be an investor and a property manager and a real estate expert, evaluator and all that kind of stuff. Most people say something along the lines of, I would like to develop passive income, maybe to the extent that I don't have to work anymore. And I want it to be passive in true meaning, so relatively hands-off. Not that I don't ever want to be involved, but not that I have to do something on a very regular basis. And when I then say, well, that's exactly how I started and brought my clients to turnkey providers, the first reaction is, well, isn't that very expensive? And I think part of the point that you just made is a really much appreciated is if you get the value and the benefit out of paying a little more but having everything done for you, then it's a fair deal. If it were that it basically makes no difference, like I think you agreed, it made a difference. Yes, you have more cash flow now, but you also had more pain and potentially more risk in the beginning. That's basically always been my argument. You want to look for what is really your intention with these investments and what is ultimately your goal. So talking about goals, where do you see yourself taking this endeavor of being, like you called it, a real investor now?
I mean, our goal is to get the cash flow to a level where we're able to quit our jobs, right? We're pretty lucky actually in that both my wife and I really enjoy what we do. So it's not a urgent scenario for us. But we want to get to that point and we want to be able to keep it as passive as possible. Yeah, get to that point sooner than later.
Yeah, absolutely. And have you, if you were to describe it, if it were like starting number one and that point would be 100, how far do you feel have you gotten so far?
Yeah, I mean, we're probably, you know, on a scale of 1 to 10, probably at the 3 or 4, you know. Yeah. So we're almost halfway to where we want to be. You know, we are starting a new tactic. We're actually, you know, you mentioned the HELOC. We did open a HELOC in one of our properties. Mm-hmm. And so now our approach, we're kind of shifting a little bit to try and leverage the BRRRR strategy a little bit more to kind of speed things up. Recycle that cash a bit, playing our own bank, right? You know, using the cash from the HELOC to get in there, rehab a property and then refinance it. Hoping that'll speed that process along for us.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea and strategy, especially when you have a situation. I think what you cured, if I understand it right, was a situation where purely on the cash flow calculation, it didn't really pay anything out. It may even have cost you a little bit every month on those properties. Now, seems like you cured that. Now you have actual cash flow, even if you follow all the rules and make all the reserves and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And so then it becomes a matter of, okay, while you still, I mean, in this crazy market that we're living through right now, equity, even in places like Memphis and St. Louis, is growing almost like apples on trees in a way, right? And you want to see how do you get some advantage of that without necessarily giving up that actual cure of having positive cash flow, right? So I think the loan or equity line of credit approach is definitely advisable and a good idea. Now, with that, have you ever considered for any of your properties or maybe for future properties to enhance the cash flow by looking at short term versus long term?
I smile because yes, my wife and I talk about that frequently. Mm-hmm. That there's a very good chance that we could get into some short term. My perception is those are even more work, right? And you know, I mean, obviously there's property management that can go along with that as well. To a pretty steep cost. But that is definitely interesting to us and something that I wouldn't be surprised if in the next year or so, you know, we've dabbled into that. Really, from my perspective, it would be as a way to get near-term cash to go into the long-term business to help accelerate the buy and hold.
Yeah, absolutely. And for our audience, I want to just point out what I do. I don't know if you would consider yourself that way, Jason, but what I do, oftentimes people call that relatively or quite conservative, and I can easily live with that. But what it also means in this context is whether it's a property you have, Jason, in Memphis, or I have a property in Ohio somewhere, or in Alabama, or in Chicago. The first point is, do the numbers work in the traditional sense, like we just discussed, right? Like you're doing your 5% vacancy and 5% CapEx and 5% maintenance, and you do your property management and all of that, and then see how much is left in positive cash flow. And if you know that works, and I'm not so sure that we really need to test it for a year or so, but I mean, with some experience, I think we both have gotten to that point to say, I can see this would work. Which then in turn also means if you then run the analysis to say, would I want to do this in short term, meaning like Airbnb, VRBO, something like that, then this fallback option is always there. Because if it works when you run the numbers on long term and then you try short term, yes, you take a maybe a temporary risk for 6 to 9 months or something like that. But you know, you could, if out of some reason, whatever the circumstances are, it doesn't end up working out the way you want it, you can go back. Now, one of the things that I find quite fascinating is the social aspect. And I'm really curious what you think about it. Because, and it got triggered when you said, well, we transitioned from dabbling in it and basically doing it like a hobby and transitioning it into really more a professional thing and seeing yourself and your wife as an investor. And that is, how can I, in the sense that we, from the cultural aspect, always being mentioned, business owners with social responsibility, how can I contribute to the economy, mm-hmm. right? And the first thing, I guess, in any small business is, okay, well, if I want to do something, that initially means I pretty much have to almost do everything by myself. And I think you gave a great example when you first started with the properties, whether it was just because you had one and your wife had one, but you started out of that circumstance. And when you said, we're going to manage these now and make them available to the market, you did it all yourself initially, right? Mm-hmm. What I'm thinking is, when you go that short-term route, and that's what I'm exploring, and I'm looking for feedback from the audience and from you, Jason, how about give somebody the opportunity to manage short-term rental properties for you, for me, as an investor, in a similar way like a property manager would do that for their long-term rentals. And yes, it would definitely be more effort and more things going into it, so they would get a bigger cut, but you only do the short-term rental because it makes more revenue and more money. So you would basically, and this is my question ultimately, what do you think about, and how reasonable do you think is the idea to say you're making or allowing somebody to develop a job as a premium host or super host by being the site that provides the property?
Yeah, no, I think it's interesting. I think that, there's certainly something to be said about that specialization, right? You know, these companies that are out there that do that are clearly going to be better at running an Airbnb than I will, because I've never done it.
Me too. <Right? laughs>
So allowing them to specialize, I think, makes some sense. The counter argument, I think, would be, the percentage that you're paying them is money that's not available to us as investors to go buy a second property and hire the contractors to build that property or to rehab that property or make that available for other travelers or other long-term people as well. So it's, I think you can contribute, to society in a couple of different ways there, right? It's either creating jobs for that manager or creating more homes and appropriate costs of living for other people. So to me, I can kind of see an argument both ways there.
Do you think that the significantly higher revenue that you would get out of a short term would basically balance compared to if you were doing it long term and then wait until you have actually the means to get second property or fifth or eighth and tenth and so forth?
I think it depends. I mean, honestly, I don't know the numbers well enough in the Airbnb world. Make sure that we have everything stabilized and our buy and hold right now before I start chasing too many rabbits down the hole. It's definitely something I have an eye to for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, me too. And the reason I brought it up is when you look at investing, especially real estate investing, more through a professional lens and not just something that is somehow sitting on the side, I think like any other business, we need to basically have our head on a swivel in a sense to say, mm-hmm. what's happening in the economy, what's happening with lending, what's happening with tenants, what's happening in markets that used to be hot for vacation or whatever reason or certain industries. And you mentioned Memphis, and one of the things that a friend of mine once said is how many more 60s, 70s, and 80s built houses can they have for the Burr strategy, right, in Memphis? Actually a good point. They have 10 or 15 turnkey providers, and they all claim to be able to constantly find the ugly duckling in a good neighborhood. Memphis must have
that's
been
a
10 million people town that shrunk or something for having all these properties, right? But anyways, I mean, that's just a side joke a little bit. No, but I think the important thing is when you really say, I acknowledge I want to be an investor and I want to make that a significant part of my life or my profession, then looking at these different options and how can we make them so that it's balanced, right? Yes, we want to make more money or more revenue and maybe can either provide more housing to people or provide an additional job. Cool, very, very nice. So coming towards the end, we always like to ask a few questions to all our guests. And is there somebody that you admire particularly that you would love to meet? And if so, who is it and why?
Well, you probably hear this one a lot, right? But Robert Kiyosaki and his whole concept of the cash quadrant, really kind of opened my eyes. I, like others, right? I went to school, got my degree. In my case, it was engineering, and went and got a job and did all that and thought that's what you do, right? Until you're 65. Yeah. And so, again,
I have to say until you're 70.
yeah, that depends. That's true. Yes. Yeah. So that really opened my eyes to changing the mindset. So I think it would be amazing to be able to meet him and pick his brain.
And for the audience, can you just real quick say what the quadrants are, or at least why they fascinated you and what the different quadrants mean?
Yeah. So you're going to test me there. I'm not sure I know all the quadrants offhand, but the concept that I took away from the book is that, you can be an employer who's kind of dependent on somebody else to create a job for you and allow you, quote unquote, allow you to work there. And, the concept that stuck with me is, every hour you work, you get paid. And if you break your leg, government aside, you're no longer getting a paycheck, right? And so you're kind of always at risk if that company goes under, if you get hurt, if you're unable to work, whatever it is. Whereas if you get over to the investor side, our rental properties, no matter what happens to me, if I break my leg, if I, whatever, my investment properties are going to continue to make money. And so that concept of passive income versus active income, sounds simple, but it was really an aha moment for me. And that's really what he's describing with the quadrant and really throughout the whole book is get away from that active income.
Yeah, and you're absolutely right. And that's how I see it too. I mean, anybody who's interested can just go on Google and put in the four quadrant for Kiyosaki, and it flows together with Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and so forth. But the idea is basically on the left side, you are dependent on other people or other businesses and jobs and all those kind of circumstances. On the right side of that four quadrant model, you are basically in charge. Either because you employ people who provide a service or a product and make a service and a product, or like you and I in the investment world, where we're not even doing that, we are basically using money to work for us rather than having to work for money, right? So that's kind of in a nutshell. For a long time, said the same thing, Jason, and then I came to realize the guy is on so many podcasts and TV and stuff like that. It feels like I kind of know him,
right? And so. That's probably true too. Yeah. But he's always a good interview on those. So blunt, very direct. So, and
Exactly. And then the second question that we like to ask is, if you had a time machine, where would you go and why?
Yeah. I mean, I think for me, I'd go back to 21-year-old me who had just graduated from college and say, start saving your money for investing. Because if I had bought two houses back then, instead of one house, I'd have twice the equity, and I'd, instead of buying five cash flow properties, I'd be buying 10 and certainly plausible, but not part of my plan. And I never, when I bought my first home, it was never as an investment. It was, to own a house, right? Thinking about them as investments and being able to go back and tell myself, no, get another one of those, do more of this. Early in your career or early in your life, I think would pay dividends.
Oh, okay. Cool. Yeah, I find that question actually kind of fascinating, because we never really talk about, are we retaining everything we know right now and take that with us when we go there? And, for those who are into like science fiction, they might say, are we changing the space-time continuum when we make those kind of things, right?
That's true.
Because
butterfly effect, right?
One of my guests actually said, well, if I can go and know everything I know right now, before I go, I would look up all the, who won the World Series and what was the lottery numbers and when was the perfect day to get in the stock market. I said, no, you have amnesia on that. You can only. But that's, that's kind of like an interesting little side note. But yeah, I hear you. And that's, I think, is something for all of us to keep in mind, the best day is probably today or tomorrow, since you can't go back and start 25 years ago.
I would agree. Yeah.
So with that being said, besides thanking you again for being on the show and sharing a little bit of your story, is there something where if somebody wants to ask you some questions or get in touch with you and hear a little bit more about what Jason does and your wife, how would they do that?
Yeah, I mean, we're in the process of kind of standing up a website right now. So we're probably not all the way set up for that. You know, a LinkedIn profile, you know, Jason Rodewalt, I'm available on there and happy, you know, some of the other forums, the real estate forums, I'm pretty active on. So that would be a way to connect with me.
I thank you very much for making the time. Say hello to your wife, and I hope we can do it again sometime.
Great. Appreciate your time as well, Axel. It's good talking to you. Thanks.
Thanks for listening, and I hope you enjoyed today's episode of the Ideal Investor Show. More info and the links we mentioned during the show are in the show notes, or you can go to our website at idealwealthgrower.com and sign up for the Apple Podcast link. And if you like to talk to me, sign up for a strategy call. Hopefully you want to share what you learned with your network and bring more people in. We are really eager to hear your comments. And until next time, be well, stay safe, and ciao.